Welcome to the next topic in induction motor. Last lecture we discussed the concept of the sleep and the induced EMF. Now we are going to discuss the starting torque and other torque condition. So let us start our discussion with what is the starting torque. So the torque developed by the motor at the instant of starting is called starting torque. So when the motor is starting, whatever the torque is developed, that is known as the starting torque. In some cases, it is greater than the normal running condition. So, normal running condition means at a particular load when the motor is rotating. So, it is greater, whereas in some cases, it is somewhat less compared to the starting torque. Now, why the starting torque is important, that we are going to see. So, if we consider that E2 is the rotor EMF per phase, so whatever the calculation we are doing per phase basis will be always per phase basis. So, E2 is the rotor EMF per phase basis. Now note here we are taking at standstill condition. So at standstill condition means the rotor has not started rotating and it is stationary. So E2 is the rotor EMF per phase at standstill condition. Similarly, the rotor resistance per phase is given by R2. So here R2 is not changing for when the rotor is rotating or stationary. It is due to the conductors that is present inside the rotor, so that governs the value of R2. So induced EMF will change with the speed of the rotor. So similarly, if you talk about the reactance per phase, that is X2, and it is also at the standstill condition, because when the rotor will be rotating, the induced EMF will change and obviously the reactance will also change in the machine. Then the total impedance of the machine will be given as under root R2 square plus X2 square, where R2 is the rotor resistance and X2 is the rotor reactance, and that we are taking at the standstill condition, because here the X2 will change when the rotor will be rotating. So correspondingly the Z2 will also change. So the current that is flowing in the rotor conductors is basically the rotor EMF E2 divided by the rotor impedance Z2, and Z2 we can substitute as under root R2 square plus X2 square. So cos phi 2, that is the power factor of the rotor, is given by R2 by Z2 is equal to R2 divided by under root R2 square plus divided by plus X2 square. So this is the power factor of the rotor. So last discussion we have done that the torque is basically proportional to flux and the current I2, and we have the power factor cos phi 2, and flux was proportional to E2. So the equation of the torque was E2 I2 cos phi 2 constant of proportionality K1, and that equation can be given as the starting torque. So starting torque is equal to K1 E2 I2 cos phi 2. If we substitute what is the value of I2 that we have deduced in the previous slide discussion, so I2 can be substituted as the net EMF of the rotor divided by the total impedance, and cos phi 2 can be substituted as R2 by Z2. So this we have substituted the value of the I2 and what is the value of cos phi 2. So we get an equation of the starting torque as starting torque is equal to K1, the constant of proportionality. Now here E2 and another E2 will multiply each other, so we get E2 square and R2 divided by R2 square plus X2 square. So here one thing we have to note is that basically the rotor resistance is and reactance is basically under the standstill condition. So rotor reactance is not changing, it is under standstill condition. When the rotor will be rotating, obviously the value of X2 will change, and rotor resistance R2 will not change. So if the supply voltage is constant, so if the supply voltage is constant, then flux and both EA2, that is the rotor EMF, both will be constant. So one holding the voltage to be constant, the flux and E2 both are constant. So starting torque equation, whatever we have, we can just substitute as starting torque equation is equal to K2 into R2 by R2 square plus X2 square is equal to K2 R2 by Z2 square. So we have an equation of Z2 square. Now, if we substitute the value of K1, which is a constant of proportionality 3 by 2 pi ns in the equation here, so K1 is basically a constant of proportionality whose magnitude is 3 by 2 pi ns. So the starting torque equation, we are getting 3 by 2 pi ns into E2 square, that is the square of the induced EMF, into the rotor resistance R2 divided by the impedance square. So the square root vanishes and we getting R2 square plus X2 square. Here one point we have to note very carefully, that the synchronous speed ns that we are going to take is basically in revolution per second. So ns we are going to take in revolution per second and not in revolution per minute. So we are not going to take in revolution per minute, because this equation has been derived in such a way that the ns synchronous speed is in revolution per second. So this is the most fundamental equation for the starting torque. So let us see what is the starting torque of a squirrel cage motor, and then we will discuss what is the starting torque of a slip ring motor. So the resistance of the squirrel cage motor is fixed. So we know that construction of the squirrel cage motor, that it is made up of bars on the rotor side, so we can't change the resistance and it is fixed and small as compared to its reactance. So obviously the resistance will be small as compared to the reactance, which is very large, especially at the start. So when we take at the starting point, then it will be very large, because at standstill the frequency of the rotor current is equal to supply frequency. So that we have discussed, that the supply frequency and the rotor frequency will be same at the starting position. So at the starting condition, we can say that the rotor resistance R2 is very, very small as compared to the value of X2. Now, when the starting current I2 of the rotor, through very large in magnitude, lags a very large angle behind E2. So if you say the angle between E2 and I2, that is the rotor EMF and I2, this angle is very large, which result that the starting torque per ampere is very poor. So we know that the torque will be very poor because the power factor is poor, and we have a low power factor, torque will be less. It is roughly 1.5 times the full load torque. So if you compare the starting torque with respect to the full load torque, so it is 1.5 times the full load torque, although the starting current is 5 to 7 times the full load current. So the current is very high, 5 to 7 times, but the torque is very low, that is 1.5 times the full load torque. The reason being is that the power factor is very poor in nature. So hence, such motors are not very useful where the motor has to drive a very heavy load at the starting. So a squirrel cage motor has a very poor starting torque, which is 1.5 times the full load torque, and the starting current is very high, 5 to 7 times. Hence, at the starting, when heavy load is there, we do not prefer the squirrel cage motor. So can we say what is about the slip ring motor? So the starting torque of the slip ring motor is increased by improving its power factor, which is not possible in squirrel cage motor. Because in slip ring motor, we have seen in the construction that external resistance can be added to the circuit through a star connected rheostat. So on, we know that the value of cos phi 2 is equal to the rotor resistance R2 by Z2. So if we increase the value of R2 by adding external resistance, obviously the value of cos phi 2 will increase, hence the starting torque will increase. So that is the main aim, that we have the construction of the slip ring induction motor where there is a provision of adding an external resistance in the circuit. So the rheostat resistance being progressively cut out as the motor gathers speed. So we have discussed about the starting condition. Now when the rotor is basically gathering the speed, the resistance that is there in the connected in the star format is cut out so that maximum speed can be attained. So addition of external resistance increase the rotor impedance and so reduce the rotor current. So cos phi 2 which is equal to R2 by Z2. So when you are basically increasing the value of R2, basically this will increase Z2 also, and the current will reduce. So the starting current will obviously less as compared to the squirrel cage induction motor. So at first, the effect of the improved power factor predominates the current, decreasing the effect of impedance. So when we are adding an external resistance, first the power factor will come into a play, and power factor will be dominating as compared to the current. So hence the starting torque is increased in that case. But after a certain point of time, when the rotor gathers speed, the effect of increased impedance is predominating. Now the power factor is not there, we have the impedance predominating. The effect of improved power factor, and so the torque starts decreasing. So starting torque, although it is quite high as compared to the squirrel cage induction motor, at the running condition if we see, then squirrel cage induction motors are better as compared to slip ring motor. So we'll discuss what is the condition when we get maximum starting torque. So we know that equation of the starting torque, is basically proportional to the rotor resistance R2 divided by Z2 square. So Z2 can be written as R2 square plus X2 square. So if we differentiate the starting torque with respect to the rotor resistance, because the resistance is the one which is going to change with respect to the external rheostat. So if we differentiate the starting torque with respect to R2 and equate with zero, then what is the condition we are basically getting? So we are getting R2 square plus X2 square is equal to 2R2 square on solving this equation. And hence, finally, we say that R2 is equal to X2. So what is the conclusion that we can draw from this particular equation? That the starting torque will be maximum when the rotor resistance and rotor reactance are equal. So starting torque is maximum when R2 is equal to X2. So the rotor resistance should be equal to rotor reactance to keep the starting torque maximum. Next topic is basically what is the effect of change in supply voltage on the starting torque. So how the voltage plays an important role in taking the starting torque equation. So we know that the torque was proportional to E2 I2 cos of phi2. So E2 plays a very important role. So E2, which is we have taken induced EMF, and these E2 take place when due to the supply voltage V. So we know that we have a stator and the rotor, and the stator is being given a three-phase supply with respect to the supply voltage V at a certain frequency FS, and this rotor is rotating with when induced EMF and current is there. So E2, that is the rotor EMF at the standstill condition, is basically proportional to the supply voltage. So E2 is proportional to the supply voltage. Now the starting torque equation, we have seen that starting torque equation is K1 E2 square R2 by Z2 square, and here we can just substitute the value of E2 square, that is the induced EMF square, as V square, because E2, which was the induced EMF on the rotor, is proportional to the supply voltage. So we get an equation where the starting torque is proportional to square of the voltage by R2 by Z2 square. So here main point is to that indicate that the starting torque is proportional to square of the supply voltage. So here we can deduce that the starting torque is proportional to square of the supply voltage. Thus torque is very sensitive to change in the supply voltage. So if you change the supply voltage, you are basically taking a square of the change in the torque. So a change of 5% in the voltage, supply voltage, will produce a change of approximately 10% in the rotor torque. So 5% change of the voltage will produce 10% change in the starting torque. So voltage is very sensitive in this case. Hence, to change the voltage, we do not connect directly to the supply, rather an auto transformer is used. So auto transformer, we should change slowly so that the supply voltage changes slowly, and hence the torque related with the voltage changes slowly. Now we will discuss what is rotor EMF and reactance under the running condition. So we have seen that E2 and X2 both are under the standstill condition. So under the standstill condition, you have the rotor EMF and rotor reactance. So what is happening under the running condition? So at standstill condition, your slip is 1 and the frequency of the supply and the rotor frequency are equal. But E2, which is at standstill condition, is maximum because the relative speed between the rotor and the revolving stator flux is maximum. So this is your stator and you have the rotor. The rotor is stationary with a slip 1, and the field which is present in the air gap is rotating at a speed of synchronous speed. Hence the relative motion V, relative speed V between the stator flux and the rotor is maximum, and that will induce an EMF E2 in the rotor. Now in fact, induction motor is equivalent to three-phase transformer with short-circuited rotating secondary. So we have seen that in the transformer we have one primary winding and we have in the secondary winding. If we short circuit the secondary winding, so this is basically our rotor, and the supply voltage is being given to the stator. And here, instead of having an iron, we will be having an air gap. So induction motor, that is a three-phase induction motor, is analogous to three-phase transformer with the rotor or the secondary winding of the transformer being short circuited. So under the running condition, the induced EMF is proportional to the relative speed. So relative speed of the stator field and the rotor, and E2 is the induced EMF in the standstill condition. So relative speed, what it will happen when the rotor will gather a speed, obviously the relative speed will decrease. So we can write under the running condition some of the equation of the rotor induced EMF ER is equal to S into E2, where E2 is the rotor EMF at the standstill condition. FR, that is the frequency of the rotor current, is equal to S into F2, that is F2 is basically equal to FS at the standstill condition. XR, that is the rotor reactance, is equal to S into X2, where X2 is the rotor reactance under the standstill condition. So we have seen that all these three, induced EMF, frequency and the rotor reactance, will be equal to S time, that is the slip time, the correspondingly standstill conditions. So standstill conditions will be multiplied with the slip to get under the running conditions. So due to decrease in the frequency of E2, XR also decreases. So what happened, if you see the frequency equation here, the value of the slip is less than 1. So obviously the frequency will decrease the rotor current when the rotor gathers speed. So if the frequency is decreasing, what happened to the reactance? So X, we know that XL is equal to omega L, and omega we can write as 2 pi F into L. So if the frequency is decreasing, obviously the reactance will decrease. So rotor reactance will decrease when the motor gathers the speed. So what happened to the torque under the running condition? We have seen the torque under the starting condition. So let us see the torque under the running condition. So under the running condition, we can write an equation of the torque. Instead of I2, we are writing IR. So we have seen that torque is proportional to flux, and here we have taken I2. So here it will become starting torque. So cos of phi 2. So if I2, that is the rotor current in the standstill condition, so it gives a starting torque. If we take the current under the running condition, so it will give you the running torque. So we know that the running current, the current of the rotor under the running condition IR, is basically the induced EMF ER divided by the total impedance under the running condition. so ZR. Also, we know that cos phi 2 is basically equal to R2, which is always constant, divided by ZR. So instead of Z2, we are putting ZR, because under the running condition, the net impedance will change. So obviously, the torque equation will become now E2 into ER by ZR into R2 by ZR. So here what we can write, that the running torque is proportional to ER, which we have taken from here, and we can substitute the value of ER, that is the induced EMF under the running condition, is equal to the slips time the induced EMF under the standstill condition. So S into E2, we can substitute the value of ER, and the value of ZR, that is the impedance under the running condition, we can substitute as under root R2 square plus S into X2 square, because XR, that is the reactance under the running condition, is equal to S into X2, that is the reactance under the standstill condition. Similarly, here also you have the value of ZR. So ZR is equal to R2 square plus S into X2 whole square. So what is the equation we are getting now? The torque equation now is directly proportional to slip into E2 square. So we have one E2 here and second E2 here. So we'll get E2 square into R2 from here. And you are having, because these are multiplied two times, so obviously the square root will vanish, and we'll have R2 square plus X into X2 square. And we have put the constant of proportionality 3 by 2 pi ns. So we are getting an equation of the running torque is equal to 3 by 2 pi ns, which is the constant of proportionality, multiplied with the some ratio, that is S having the slip, into square of the EMF under the standstill condition, multiplied by the rotor resistance R2, divided by, we have the ZR under the square. So here we can see that, and if we substitute the value of the slip as 1, obviously we get the starting torque. So if you remember the starting torque equation, there the slip was not there, because under the starting condition your slip was 1. So substituting slip 1, you get the TR is equal to TST, that is the starting torque equation. So what is the condition of maximum torque under the running condition? So we have seen that when R2 is equal to X2, this is the condition of having the starting torque to be maximum. So same thing what we understood and try to understand, that under the running condition, what is the under the running condition, what is the maximum torque conditions? So this is the torque equation under the running condition. So we are having a constant of proportionality, which is equal to 3 by 2 pi ns, and here you have the slip term with the induced EMF and slip term with the rotor reactance. So to make calculation simple, because we have to take the derivative in order to find the maximum torque, so it is better to take the derivative when taking the reciprocal, that is y is equal to 1 by tr. This we have done to make the calculation simpler. So on doing this, what we are getting from this equation, dy by ds, we differentiate the reciprocal of the torque equation, and we try to find by equating with 0. So the reciprocal of the torque equation, we are differentiating with respect to the slip. If you remember, we have differentiated in the beginning with the torque starting with respect to dr2, because the rotor resistance was the one which was changing. Now here we are differentiating with respect to the slip, because the relative velocity plays a very important role in governing the induced EMF and the rotor reactance, so that we are equating with 0. So if we do that, we are getting a condition this. So final condition is basically R2 is equal to S into X2. So maximum torque under the running condition is basically giving a condition R2 is equal to S into X2. So when a rotor resistance is equal to slip time the rotor reactance, our running condition is maximum. Torque under running condition is maximum. Starting torque is maximum when our rotor resistance is equal to rotor reactance. So if we carefully observe these two equations, we find that if we multiply with the slip with the rotor reactance, we get the condition of the running, because at starting your slip is 1. So the same equation, same conditions we are getting for both the starting torque equation as well as the running torque equation. So the torque under the running condition is maximum when the rotor resistance is slip time the rotor reactance. And what is the maximum torque then? So the maximum torque after substituting the values of the quantities, we get the maximum torque as 3/2πNS, that is a constant of proportionality, into E2 square by 2 times X2. So we see that torque maximum is proportional to the supply E2 square, that is the induced EMF square, divided by the 2 times the rotor reactance. So rotor reactance plays an important role, and the induced EMF plays an important role. Also, the induced EMF is proportional to the supply voltage. So change in the supply voltage will change the torque, and the change in the rotor reactance will also change the maximum torque. So some of the conclusions we are going to draw, that the maximum torque is independent of R2. So we see that there is no R2 in the torque maximum equation. So maximum torque is independent of the rotor resistance. However, the speed or slip at which the maximum torque occurs is determined by R2, because we have seen the condition R2 is equal to slip time X2. So slip is basically R2 by X2. So if we see the maximum torque equation, which is independent of R2, but the slip is the governing factor which is determined on R2. So the slip at which maximum torque occurs is basically determined by R2 only. So by varying R2, which is only possible in slip ring motor and not in squirrel cage motor, the maximum torque can be made to occur at any desired slip. So condition of maximum torque is R2 is equal to S into X2, and S, that is the slip, is equal to R2 by X2. And so if we change the value of the rotor resistance, we can change the slip. We can change the slip, it means that we can change the maximum torque equation at any value of slip. But this is only possible in slip ring motor, because that has the provision to change the rotor resistance. So maximum torque is inversely proportional to rotor reactance. So we have seen that the maximum torque equation is directly proportional to E2 square by 2 times X2. So we can say that the maximum torque is inversely proportional to the rotor reactance. Hence, it should be kept as small as possible. So X2 should be small, then only the torque will be more. Torque maximum is proportional to V square, because V is proportional to the E, that is the induced EMF. So any change in the supply voltage is very dangerous, because maximum torque will produce very easily. So for obtaining the maximum torque at starting, we put S equal to 1, then R2 is equal to X2. Because we know that R2 is equal to S into X2. So if you put S equal to 1, we are basically getting the standstill condition, and we'll get the condition R2 is equal to X2. Then this maximum torque will become the starting condition maximum. There is something which we say breakdown torque, so that we are going to see. So the rotor torque at any slip S can be expressed in terms of the maximum torque. Maximum torque is known as the breakdown torque by the following equation. So this is the equation which have been given empirically to find the torque at any particular slip, which is basically related with the breakdown torque or the maximum torque. So if SB, that is the breakdown or pullout slip, so we get an equation this. So having known the maximum torque TB and the slip SB, we can also find at what value of another slip S you will get the rotor torque. So this equation is very important. So we can say that the relationship between the rotor torque and the breakdown torque or the maximum torque with respect to the breakdown slip. So this completes the discussion on this particular lecture of the starting torque and the running torque, which is very important in induction motor. The conditions of the torque and most of the numerical will be solved based on the equations discussed in this particular lecture. Thank you for now.